This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Thanks for listening to the ungated version of the Unsupervised Learning podcast. If you want to read some essays on some of these topics, please check out razib.substack.com. Again, that's razib.substack.com. Thank you.
Hey, everybody. This is Razib with the Unsupervised Learning podcast. I am here today with someone I have talked to three or four times over the last dozen years or so about various sundry topics, usually related to evolution. And so I'm here with David Sloan Wilson. I'll let David introduce himself with all his various projects. But the reason I want to talk to David is I want to talk about multi-level selection theory and various topics related to evolution and see where we are in 2023. My own experience with David's work goes back probably 20 years when I encountered his book, Unto Others, more than 20 years now. Wow. In any case, it's been a while. But, there's various controversies related to that, debates, scientific debates that have happened, papers that have come out, and, a whole field really has come into its own cultural evolution, which I think is quite related to multi-level selection theory. And so I want to talk about some of those things. But first, David, why don't I let you introduce yourself? And I think the last time we talked to you, or I talked to you, I think your memoir was about to come out, and so that did come out. So you've been busy, but why don't you? I'll let you go.
Yeah. So you're looking back on history, and I can do that even more so. And I think this conversation, in part, will be about the last 50 years of intellectual thought. Now I'm president of Prosocial World, which is a nonprofit that's really dedicated to conscious cultural evolution in real world settings. I'm a retired professor of biology and anthropology at Binghamton University, but I work now mostly through this nonprofit, Prosocial World, which spun off from my previous nonprofit, the Evolution Institute. And for us, it's all about studying and stewarding cultural evolution. Studying means basic scientific research. Yes, I still do that. And stewarding means actually making things better in the real world. And it's a very fulfilling life, and I'm happy to talk about it.
Awesome. Yeah, we'll get to that. I want to first start out with a catchphrase. Well, I don't know if it's a catchphrase, but it's a phrase that I hear a lot, for the good of the species. And the term, I usually, when someone says it, I usually push back a little bit. And I try to say, well, it's a little bit more complicated than that. We don't necessarily do things for the good of the species. I think my usual argument would be there's nothing that privileges the species, however you define it, partly because our definitions are not always clear and distinct about what that means. A classical response by some biologists would be that evolution selects at the level of the individual. In terms of your own particular reproductive fitness, not the reproductive fitness of your species. People would then, in a common sense way, respond, well, then why do people sacrifice for their species or their group? So all of these discussions emerge out of that. And, there were arguments in evolutionary biology in the 1960s around this topic. Have been pushing forward this theory of multi-level selection, which I think you've been in this game since the 70s at this point, right?
Yep.
So can you talk about your own perspective, like how you approach the good of the species question?
Well, first, let's be careful about the units that we're talking about. It might be for the good of the species. It might be for the good of the social group. Or it might be for the good of the ecosystem. And in each case, social group, ecosystem, species, we have some larger, higher level entity that's comprised of individuals. And if we want, we can decompose individuals down to their genes, can't we? And I think the way to begin is to pick one of those higher level units, the social group, and then later on I can extend it to ecosystems and species. So the basic problem here is that if you imagine a behavior that is for the good of the group, that's what we call a pro-social behavior, any behavior oriented towards the welfare of others or one's group as a whole, there's an inherent fitness disadvantage associated with pro-social behaviors compared to other individuals that are more self-serving. This is very, very easy to understand. The altruist is vulnerable to the selfish individual within the same group. So there's a force of evolution at the most local scale, the individuals that are actually interacting with each other, that pulls against prosocial behavior. And Darwin encountered this early on. This was the one category of behavior that he could not explain with his theory of natural selection, of competition among individuals. So let me pause there, and then I'll take the next step after you reflect upon that.
Yeah. You mentioned selection at the level of genes, which was pretty abstract. I think when your career began in some ways, and now I work in the field of genomics, and we have a lot of empirical evidence that there is intragenomic competition, so within your own genome, so selfish genetic elements, like the repetitive elements across the genomes of a lot of organisms. So this is not simply abstract anymore, and we can actually quantify it. Like, different lineages have different proportion of these selfish genetic elements. So that is the bottommost level, I guess. And then as you scale up, as you said, you could go up to the ecosystem. And I think the definition of the group, the definition of the unit that you matter, that you care about, is super important. I also think I try to, and I don't know how you feel about this, I do try to make a distinction between the unit of selection and the fact that, it's operating through genetics in terms of the target of how I would track it. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the adaptation is necessarily so straightforward a lot of the time. And I say this partly because there are a lot of tests for natural selection that you can detect at the genomic level. But to figure out what the adaptation is, what's being selected, is not necessarily straightforward. And so I kind of see some of these issues as somewhat separable at this point, because it's been about 15 years since we've had a lot of good selection tests on the genomic level. And I can tell you many, many, many signatures of selection in many organisms, including humans. And it's quite unclear after all this time what is being adapted. That's a different, frankly, more intractable problem.
I were going to push back on quite a few of that, Razib, so we have a good conversation in front of us. And you've added a lot of modern stuff and a lot of modern mechanistic stuff with genetics. And I think that there's a back to basics movement that really defines natural selection the way Darwin did, with those three words, variation, selection, and replication. Darwin not knowing anything about mechanisms. And I think that there is a kind of a blessing, an advantage to what's now being called generalized Darwinism. What can we say on the basis of any and all processes that combine those three ingredients of variation, selection, and replication? Right away, that takes us away from a gene-centric view. I mean, you're a very broad-minded person, but you actually fell into a little gene-centric trap, I would say, and you a reductionistic rabbit hole. Now we're talking about genes and signatures of adaptation that we're trying to read in the genetic material. So let me take us back to Darwin, who knew nothing about mechanisms. And what was staring him in the face was the fact that when he considered anything associated with human morality, honesty, loyalty, bravery, altruism, the Good Samaritan, all of that is helping others survive and reproduce compared to the prosocial individual. And so he said, basically, it is the case that the the brave, the loyal individual is not more fit than more selfish individuals within its own tribe, he put it. So there was the problem that he identified. I call that the original problem. And he also came up with a solution that tribes of individuals who are loyal, brave, so on, pro-social towards each other will robustly outcompete tribes that don't and cannot cohere. And so what he said was that there's two levels of natural selection taking place. There's competition among individuals within social groups, and that's weighing in favor of selfishness. And there's competition among groups in a multi-group population, that's weighing in favor of pro-social behavior. So now we have, he could explain pro-social behaviors now, thanks to a process of between-group selection, but it was a force that was being opposed by another force. And so there's two-level selection. And two-level selection gets stretched out to multi-level selection. Once we do know about genes, all the stuff you were talking about is basically frame-shifting downward. And we can frame-shift upward to groups of groups of groups, which we need to do in humans. And also we can frame shift upward in the direction of multi-species ecosystems and perhaps species. And so I think what we've succeeded in doing here without bringing in mechanism, and of course we need to bring in mechanism at some point, but without needing to, we've identified the basic problem of what I call the original problem of how do we explain the evolution of pro-social behaviors and the need for higher level selection, in this case, group level selection, in order to do so. That was an insight that began with Darwin, and it remains the key insight. And there's a complicated story to tell about the 1960s. Why was this rejected? Why was group selection rejected in the 1970s? And why is it back is something, of course, we're here to discuss. But the original problem is very, very simple, and it applies to cultural evolution no less than genetic evolution. So in some ways, I prefer not to go down the genetic rabbit hole, because what we really need to know in a modern context is how do we get our own groups to function better as groups? That's the policy question. All around us, we see groups that are not functioning well, or we see groups that are functioning well, but in a disruptive fashion, creating chaos and disorder at higher scales. And so the need for multi-level selection thinking is all around it. I would say it is the policy question of our time, any time, is how do we get our societies functioning well at ever larger scales, now at the global scale? That's what everyone needs to know. And multi-level selection actually provides the answer, I would say. That's how important it is. It's not an academic, that's not merely academic. It is the policy question in front of us.
Yeah. I mean, you've gone all the way from Darwin to, you know, let's call it the existential problem of humanity in 2023, where we can eliminate ourselves through nuclear weapons. So there's, you know, there's all sorts of issues that we are confronting as a species, you know, as a planet, as life forms on Earth, right? If you want to aggregate it all the way up to that level. So, you know, one thing you alluded to, and I'll be explicit here, is the issue with inheritance and mechanism and Darwin. And, you know, Darwin was writing and thinking in a pre-genetic era, so he did not use genetics to explain inheritance. He had his own, you know, theories and ideas. But basically what you're alluding to here is natural selection is operating through heritable variation, and it's neither here nor there how that heritable variation occurs in that framework. And I want to just mention really quickly, so you mentioned the 1960s and issues with group selection and those debates. So the issue here is you have to have heritable variation at the unit. And the argument was that there wasn't enough heritable variation between groups. Well, that was one of the arguments. And so if you have no heritable variation between groups, how can selection and adaptation occur? And can I just like, can you get into like why you disagree with that, obviously? Why that argument does not hold anymore?
Yeah, sure. Sure. And as we do that, I want to emphasize mathematical modeling as a double-edged sword. And this is on my mind a lot lately, not just with evolution, but with economics. And currently I'm reading a history of Adam Smith, a biography of Adam Smith in his time by Jesse Norman, who is now actually a minister of transportation in the UK, but also a scholar. But there's so many other sources in which we could. It really begins with Newton and the magnetic attraction of mathematical models, which of course are very powerful, but also very limiting. And when you think of it, and if you've done any modeling as I have, you know that to build a model, you just have to put in so many simplifying assumptions. And so the one hand, it's so very powerful given its assumptions, but the fact that you have to make assumptions just, it amounts to a de facto denial of complexity. So also do experimentations. Experimental design by nature requires holding everything constant except one or two or at most three variables. So you take a complex world, you hold everything constant except for a handful of variables. And then since life is contextual, why should we be surprised that there's a replication problem crisis when the fact you try to replicate an experiment and it's in a setting where some of those other variables are not held constant. And guess what? You know, complexity ends up coming back to bite you. So if you look at the mathematical models that made group-level heritability appear unlikely, they're very, very simple population genetics models. They assume additive interactions among the genes. They assume a very simple relationship between the genotype and the phenotype. And if that's the case, like altruistic behavior is coded by an altruistic gene, for example, and if you imagine groups that are initiated by colonized at random by N individuals, then the variation among groups goes down. It's just as a matter of sampling error. And if N is large, then there's very little sampling error among groups. Now, in contrast, let me describe an experiment that I did with one of my students, William Swenson, in which we had microcosms. We're actually now automatically going to the ecosystem level here. Basically, they were test tubes of sterile media in which we introduce 1 milliliter of pond water. So imagine 30 test tubes and we squirt 1 milliliter of pond water into each one from a single well-mixed source. That has millions of bacteria in 1 milliliter. So there should be no sampling error should be vanishingly small. Well, we incubate them in a constant environment for 4 days, and then we start to measure things about them, such as their pH. Or in one case, we put in a toxic chemical and we measured the degree to which the ecosystem, the microcosm, was degrading the toxic chemical. And do you know we found variation? They varied after only 4 days. How is that possible? And the reason it's possible is because sensitive dependence on initial conditions. Each one of these ecosystems were actually very complex systems. And as we know from the butterfly effect, small differences don't remain small. They become the seeds for larger differences. And so thanks to complex interactions, we now had variation at the level of these ecosystems. And then we selected. We took the microcosms that had the highest pH or did the best job of degrading the toxic compound, and we used them as parents to inoculate a new generation of test tubes. And we did the same thing with soil ecosystems. And what do you know? We got a response to selection. And so if you actually, without knowing too much about the mechanisms, we black boxed the actual mechanisms. Surely we want to open the black box and know what actually happened. But we demonstrated the existence of phenotypic variation at the level of ecosystems, and heritability, because a response to selection is proof of heritability. So, and every experiment in the laboratory that's ever been done, which involves creating either single-species social groups or multi-species communities, has variation. So variation is always present. And whether it's heritable, that's quite complicated. We could get into that, but that has to, a lot to do with multiple attractors and things like that. So, so there you have it. And I think the two take-home messages there, first of all, the empirical result, do the experiment and you'll get your answer. And secondly, that experiment makes sense once we understand that the units that we're selecting are not just additive units, they're complex systems. And so that has profound implications for the, both heritability and variation and heritability.
Yeah. One thing that I will say is, you know, as I've been, reading the literature and the debates, go back to the problem of altruism in the 1960s, W.D. Hamilton, John Maynard Keynes, you know, there are a lot of simple models, very reductionist models.
John Maynard Smith, John Maynard Smith.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Not the economist, which, yeah.
You can talk about him too.
Yeah, I know that will trigger you. I know that, you know, you and the economists are, that's a whole thing. The models are quite simple and elegant, but I always would think in terms of the human context, but altruism does exist, social complexity does exist, and so there was always a gap for me between the, you know, simplifying assumptions of the models and the reality of what we see all around us. And so that was always an issue. I have a question. I haven't tracked the literature very closely. How has computation and simulation come into play, or has it at all? Because I feel like there are some situations when you do an analytical mathematical framework, that's fine. But, with simulation, that can also give you some insights.
Well, what we need to do, and this is why the long historical view is useful, is to see that two things happened in the last 50 years. One was the advent of complex system science, which just could not take place prior to widespread computing. And so we're talking about the 1970s, the 1980s. I like to remind people the Santa Fe Institute was founded in 1984, I believe. The first popular book on complex system science, Chaos, by James Gleick, The Making of a New Science, was published in 1987. What that chronicled was basically the limitations of formal analytical modeling and the liberation that took place when we supplement those models, never replace. Nobody's denying the utility of proofs in formal analytical models, but to supplement them with computer simulations of all sorts, agent-based models, digital twins, and ever more so, is just enabled you to go beyond the limitations of closed analytical models. And the demonstration of that, Razib, let me just take a few minutes, because back to the history of multi-level selection, one of the most important articles, models that led to the rejection of group selection, was by John Maynard Smith, published in 1964. He called it the haystack model, and it was a little tinker toy algebraic model in which haystacks were colonized by mice. We don't have to go into the details, but he concluded on the basis of it that group selection was a very weak force. That was 1964, and it was one of the main nails in the coffin of group selection. In 1987, I revisited the haystack model, and by then there were computer simulations were available. So I basically did a computer simulation of Maynard Smith's model, but because I could now I could relax some of his assumptions. And what I showed was his model was actually very conducive to group selection, his model. But the way these things go, with priority effects and the like, also a form of complex interactions, is that my article published in Evolution Magazine, premier journal, had no impact. No impact. Should have, but didn't, because, you know, attitudes were set at that time. Attitudes were set, and I think the whole field had fallen into a basin of attraction, to pick another complex systems term, a sociological basin of attraction that it had to escape. And that's, I think, which has taken place. If we fast forward to the present, I think this is also over, folks. There's not a big controversy anymore. I have long conversations with people like Jonathan Birch, most recently Arvid Agrin, who's the author of the book, The Gene's Eye View of Evolution, the latest word on the gene's eye view. He just did a seminar for Prosocial World. We have a long, long podcast. I could give you article, give you links in the liner notes. And at this point, there's among the academics, there's something called equivalence. Basically, what we've concluded, past tense, what we have concluded, is that all theories of social evolution are invoking the same causal forces from different perspectives. Their differences are mostly perspective differences, and it's possible to translate from one to the other. And so it's basically, as far as I'm concerned, the group selection controversy is over, which isn't to say that Richard Dawkins and Steve Pinker are ever going to change their minds. Science does progress funeral by funeral in some cases. But as far as I'm concerned, I don't bother with this too much anymore. I'm too busy applying them.
Yeah, you are. And I want to get to that. But first, I want to talk about cultural evolution, a field you've been involved in. And, you know, I feel over the last 20 years, it's really, really exploded as a field. And I talked to Richard McElrath about this. I think it was 4 years ago now. Wow, time flies. But, you know, in the 1980s, 1980s and 1990s, there's like a handful of people publishing in this area, and probably like less than a handful of people where it was their primary focus. And now there's a whole field. I know, just reading your work and Darwin's Cathedral, you know, a book you wrote, you know, about religion, you've been involved in this in various ways for a while. Why do you think cultural evolution has accelerated and just expanded over this last couple of decades? And what do you think the biggest insights of cultural evolution are? And can you also talk about why, you know, we're talking about multi-level selection. That's kind of what we're focusing on here. Why that is so important for cultural evolution. Just very specifically, I think listeners and viewers probably have some suspicion, but, you know, just let's get into it.
Oh, that's great. I'm really happy you asked the question. It'll take me about 5 minutes to provide a good answer, but that's why we're here. And one point to make is that the onset of cultural evolution is long overdue. The advent of genetics, with the advent of genetics, then the whole study of evolution became gene-centric. That's what the modern synthesis was. And this idea of generalized Darwinism, any mechanism, just yielded to a very, very gene-centric view. And so the study of cultural evolution didn't begin until the 1970s. Before that, it was eclipsed by Mendelian genetics, and as if the only way that offspring can resemble their parents is by sharing the same gene. So first of all, there was this long delay. And then what happened? Well, then what happened, I think, is... And this enables me to return to a selfish gene theory and my conversation with Arvid Agrin, in which he says, so this is really interesting, that on the one hand, Dawkins, following G.C. Williams and others, stressed that the concept of gene, the concept of selfish genes that he was developing, was not a physical unit. Don't think of a selfish gene as a bead on a string, he wanted you to know. The selfish gene is an informational unit. It's quite abstract. And that being the case, you would think that the concept of selfish genes would carry over to the concept of selfish memes. And so one of the things that happened in the 70s was the concept of was a view of cultural evolution that tried to center itself on the concept of memes as something like genes, the cultural equivalent of memes. That was Dawkins' effort. And Arvid Agrin concludes, and I agree, that that conception of cultural evolution didn't go very far. It's not for lack of trying. All sorts of people tried to make something out of memetics, but that's not what took root, and that's not what we see today. What we see today stems from the tradition of Pete Richardson, Robert Boyd, and others. Richard McElreath is part of that lineage. Joe Henrich is part of that lineage. In fact, that was the fruitful lineage, basically. If you look, just about everyone who's most active in the study of cultural evolution, Tim Waring, who just gave a seminar to Prosocial World last week, Paul Smaldino, I'm reeling off names. And all of these emanate from the Boyd and Richardson tradition, which is about cultural group selection. And so the thing about cultures that we need to know is that it operates so very strongly at the group level. In some ways, it is a return to the view of Emil Durkheim. And if you go back far enough, what you realize is that nearly everyone in the 18th and early 20th century were comfortable with the concept of human society as some kind of organism. That was a common idea back then. Of course it was. That's the whole reason that sociology existed as a discipline, was because you cannot reduce human society to individual psychology or biology, was the way put it. There's something about human society which is organic and organismal in its own right. And that's what was eclipsed by the whole age of reductionism and individualism in the social sciences, in economics. But it's what's revived now with cultural multi-level selection. Once again, we can think of whole cultures, whole human societies as impressively adaptive units. And at the beginning of this conversation, Razib, you were talking about how difficult it is to detect the signature of adaptation in certain kinds of data. But I want to counter that with the claim that it's easy, relatively easy, to detect the signature of adaptation if you just look at phenotypes. And so if, just to elaborate on that, as an evolutionary biologist, when an evolutionary biologist studies any species, any organism, in relation to its environment, that's at the phenotypic level. That's where you can say such things as, oh, the water strider is just amazingly well designed to skate over the surface of water, incredible, and so on and so forth. That's looking at the phenotype of the organism in relation to its environments before you descend into the level of mechanisms. And what I've done, and what many other people have done, it's what really Darwin's Cathedral was all about, is that if you look at a cultural system such as a religion, let's take Calvinism as it originated in the city of Geneva in the 1500s, and if you look at it at the phenotypic level, then you will be able to conclude that it is very impressively adapted to organize that human society at that scale. The mechanisms, that's another matter, but there can be very little doubt that, and not just for one case, and not just cherry-picking examples. One of the things I did after Darwin's Cathedral was I chose a random sample of religions, a truly random sample of about 35 religions, and I studied them for functional organization. And just based on what's known about them in the scholarly literature, could conclude that not each and every one of them in each and every case, not each and every detail. That's not true for species either. But Durkheim was right. Religion is all about the formation of communities. And it's taken us a long time to come back to that commonsensical view that most enduring cultural systems impressively adapt people to live in groups in their environments. That's now become, or is becoming, common sense once again. We're recovering from reductionism and individualism.
Yeah, I wanna just like highlight that question or issue. You're talking about reductionism, individualism. There's whole domains of the social sciences that are predicated on an individual view. So, you know, obviously a lot of economics, microeconomics, but also parts of evolutionary psychology are focused on that in terms of, you know, adaptation on the individual level. And I did read Darwin's Cathedral. You know, I think I read it like a year or two after it came out, and I have to say that was probably when I really started taking group selection in humans, in particular in cultures, really seriously, because I found it much more satisfying as an explanation than some of the methodologically individualist explanations for why. So, for example, Rodney Stark, the sociologist of religion, had a rational choice theory, which I read his technical books on it, and I understand like it's a rigorous theory, but honestly, it didn't seem that it was working very well in terms of predictions and other things. And in certain contexts, it worked. I mean, there are certain conditions where I think that that's fine, but there's a lot of variation in human societies, and I think that it was missing that. And so part of me does wonder, like, let's talk specifically about sociology of religion and economics. Sometimes I have wondered, is this a very American perspective? Because in America, we think of the Horatio Alger and the individual and consumption on an individual level. And I don't, I don't know what the empirical literature is, but I don't perceive that we're a very collectivist society. We make our individual choices. Until recently, kids would move out of the household. The marriage partners you make are not based on what your family thinks, all these things. Do you, what do you think about this idea that maybe some of this is just the influence of American culture at this time and moment, which is very individualistic?
Sure. So another great question that requires a long-winded answer. But I think it's important to stress that this rethinking of entire disciplines, which was taboo in the 1970s when Ed Wilson published Sociobiology, that was praised as this great synthesis, except for the study of humans. So that is a time marker for the idea that these ideas were taboo for the study of humans. But shortly after that, brave people started to call for rethinking whole disciplines, and we have the birth of evolutionary psychology, evolutionary anthropology, evolutionary economics, evolutionary religious studies, all starting in the 1970s. But looking back upon that, what we have to acknowledge is a period of maturation that was required. And if you can compare evolutionary psychology, for example, now and then, I was just at a conference with Cecilia Hayes, who has a book called Cognitive Gadgets, and she makes the same point as I'm about to make. So if you look at evolutionary psychology as it originated, with key figures such as Cosmides, Leda Cosmides, John Tooby, Steve Pinker, and so on, that was David Buss. That was very gene-centric. The story there was that, first of all, the human mind is not just a single calculator. It's many special purpose adaptations that all evolved by genetic evolution. So now we have this Swiss Army knife or jukebox of adaptations that evolved by genetic evolution in the Stone Age, and they're being triggered in the modern environment. That was the birth of evolutionary psychology. You fast forward to the present, and we have people like Joseph Henrich calling attention to weird societies, Western educated, industrial rich, and democratic, as very peculiar. And this brings us to your point that you were talking about American society, but cultural evolution runs much deeper than some kind of thin veneer over a genetically evolved human nature. You know, just go back to Cosmides and Tubi talking about, like, the human mind is like the human body. Around the world, we all have mental organs like our hearts and our livers, and they're all being triggered by different environments, but really we're just the same around the world by genetic evolution was central to their plank. And that's true in some, I mean, now so much more must be attributed to cultural evolution. That's how far we've come. And against that background, indeed, and this is also something that's fractal. It goes back to my experiment on ecosystems where I showed that even starting with almost no sampling error, you get big differences in those test tubes. That's true at any scale. And so if you look at variation among nations, you find, I mean, they're huge. They have hundreds of millions of tens and hundreds of millions of individuals. They're all different from each other in fractal fashion. So, you know, the Nordic countries are kind of occupy a cluster that happened to work very well. So we might look to the Nordic countries for examples of good governance, but they differ from each other. The United States occupies a certain position, but if you look at the 50 states within the United States, then there's variation at that. There's variation at all scales, and that we have to interpret and that we can potentially select upon. So much now is being attributed to cultural evolution. And of course, I think that's encouraging because it means that that's what we could work on, conscious cultural evolution. We can become, we always have been agents of cultural evolution, by the way. Human cultural evolution has always had an intentional component and always had a blind component. And so the interplay between blind evolution and intentional evolution is a very important thing to understand.
Yeah, let me use an illustrative, an empirical illustration of differences that I've noticed where I'm like, okay, like this is like a huge difference that matters. Like, I want to go back to religion because it's easy for people to understand relatively. In the United States, about 50% of people over their lifetime switch their religious identity in some way, depending on how you define it. And so, you know, Rodney Stark, who I alluded to earlier, and there's a whole group of economists that study religion. They look at religion in a supply side framework where it's a consumption good for an individual. And there's all these different type of denominations that they can select from. And people, you know, select what they like. And that's driving the evolution of religion. When I explain this to someone from India, they think it's insane or like super weird because almost nobody in India switches in their whole lifetime. Yeah. So, you know, it's just that framework does not work because those conditions do not hold. And so this is the kind of thing that I'm talking about when I see models that use individual human action to drive everything. And I'm like, okay, well, but there's constraints on that. And those constraints vary from society to society. And so you have to look at the details here. It's kind of like how in genetics we have model organisms, you know, and those are informative, but there's a whole counter narrative now, which is pretty robust, that just looking at mice for diseases has caused serious problems in generalizing to humans. And so I think this is a general pattern, but I wanted to like put the focus on religion. And I want to go back to that. At the end of Darwin's Cathedral, I remember you saying that you were involved in creating like pro-social organizations or entities for people that are maybe not, you know, they don't believe in God or traditional religion. And since you wrote Darwin's Cathedral, there has been a massive spike in disaffiliation in the United States over the last generation. Can you talk a little bit about that, just in terms of the various projects with the EVOS project and all these other projects that you've been working on that have been very public policy oriented? And this is where, we've alluded to economists several times. Those are kind of the kings and queens of policy academia. And so you have impinged on their territory. So I know that's like open-ended, but I do want to get to some of the applications of, you know, these fascinating topics that we're talking about, which obviously both of us are interested in, but, you know, these have real-world consequences that you're trying to apply here.
Yeah, well, again, thank you. And I think that another thing to accentuate of about this. It's called dual inheritance theory. It's very much emanating from the Richardson Boyd tradition. And it simply notes that in our species, there's two streams of inheritance, a genetic stream and a cultural stream. And that cultural stream, I think it encourages us to think of everything inside our heads as like our genotype. So the way I put it, you know, you are a collection of genes. We all are. Those genes influence just, we call that your genotype. Those genes influence just about everything that could be measured about you. We call that your phenotype. Because you're a human, you also have some meaning system inside your head, some collection of symbols, which also informs just about everything that could be, influences just about everything that could be measured about you. Your very same phenotype. So we call that your symbotype to stress your comparison. Everyone has one. And so this is not like religion versus something else. We all have a meaning system, and our meaning system, whatever it might be, influences how we think and act and behave. And for me, that is very important because it locates the central object of study as meaning systems in all of their forms. And it makes religion one kind of meaning system, one kind of meaning system. That's very important. And so just as genotypes in non-human species, they result in individuals that are actually flexible. Every genotype results in a degree of phenotypic plasticity. They endow the organism with a way to respond to its environment, but it's a limited repertoire. And I'll finish up here in just a minute, Razib. If we think the same way about symbotypes, that whatever it is inside your head gives you a degree of flexibility, a repertoire for responding to your world, but that's a limited repertoire. And if you want to go beyond that repertoire, you must change what's on the inside. You must change your symbotype in order to change how we act. And that's true for the individual, and it's true for the culture. So this is the sense in which we can study any meaning system or any culture from this perspective. And it's essentially the way that biologists study genetic diversity and organic diversity. We should be thinking about cultural diversity in the same way. And I think it's quite friendly to what you were saying beforehand about how when you go to India, it's just a whole different set of conditions. There's a sense it's not comparable in the same way that if I'm studying bears and starfish, I don't expect them to be just alike. They're different. So it's the whole package that's been developed for the study of genetic evolution in some ways can be moved over to the study of cultural diversity. I hope that made some sense.
No, it did. You know, it's an interesting viewpoint because, you know, we are both Americans, and you know, I love this country, and it's diverse in many ways. But I have, maybe this is, I say it, maybe it's my age, but I have been feeling of late that we can be a bit myopic, and there are models of living differently, living just as well, maybe even better in some ways, elsewhere. And you know, people we talk about, you know, we have the internet, we can read about it, everything, we can watch YouTubes, we can immerse ourselves in some ways in other cultures and get a slice of their lives. And I do feel sometimes that this isn't just Americans, but I'm going to speak as an American, this is my perspective, where we have the tools to learn from other cultures. We say this is a generic thing people say, but I feel like we don't take it too seriously. And fundamentally, we work within our own system in terms of we are bears in Alaska. That's what we know. We might look at other species, you know, but we don't learn from them. And that is just something that I've been thinking, partly talking to friends of mine from other countries who do give me different perspectives. You know, obviously, you know, I have friends that still have friends in academia and industry that immigrated from Europe or Asia or Africa, Latin America, etc. And yeah, just concretely, like I have a friend and he is a behavior geneticist. He is from Latin America, and we have a long discussion. And we can speak in the same language in terms of genetics and science, and neither of us are religious. There's a lot of commonalities, but I can sometimes get such startlingly different perspectives because he grew up in a different country, not in the United States. And he has told me, you know, I'll just say he's in academia, that sometimes he feels like Americans are very insulated and insular and he can't break through. And so, you know, the Latin American graduate students hang out with the Latin American graduate students. And I don't know, I'm rambling, but it's just something that I feel like we haven't taken advantage of the technologies we have to learn from other cultures and actually synthesize. We're still kind of doing the same thing as if we're the only nation. And, you know, I'm sure other nations are the same. Just like this independent parallel track instead of a synthetic track. I don't know. What do you think about that?
Well, absolutely. Deeply and besmirchingly, we're provincial. And this is a point that's made by Joe Henrich and others, that when you think that 98% of science and scholarship takes place in this one culture, this broadly weird culture, which itself is diverse, by the way, you know, you might say is Latin America weird, Western educated, industrial rich, and democratic? I don't know, but it is different. These differences that you're noting, and once again, are fractal. The regions of the United States are different, very different, and they have a way of maintaining themselves despite massive mixing. How is that possible? But it is. So what's on offer, I think, is that when you truly appreciate that cultural diversity is like biological diversity, it does teach a certain kind of humility that my culture might be well adapted to my environment. And by the way, not entirely. Here's where the whole non-adaptive side of the evolutionary coin comes in. Here's where evolutionary mismatch comes in. We have to be able to spot the absence of adaptation in addition to the presence of adaptation. But in just the same way that biologists love and respect all of the species that they study, even predators and parasites, every organism is worth admiring as a product of evolution that's adapted to its environment. What if we could say that for every culture? Then I think that would be, and also when we appreciate that that reductionism and individualism has been a handicap, and that is something that we need to recover from, we can go to other cultures that never had that handicap. And I think the thing about indigenous cultures in particular is that they didn't have the luxury of being reductionistic. And so there's something about many forms of indigenous thought which are more systemic, involving pattern recognition without claiming to understand the underlying causes, and they're the better for it. So there's a sense in which we can learn from other forms of thought, deeply learn from indigenous forms of thought, which isn't to say that we can over-romanticize them, because another point you could make is that there might not be many human universals, but there are evolutionary universals. And so, for example, in any situation where there's an imbalance of power and there's a rupture in social control and some individuals or factions can get their way, they will, because that's an evolutionary dynamic. It's not the dynamic of any species. It's true for all forms of social behavior. And so without checks and balances, you will not get prosocial society. We can say that for all cultures. So there, in the same way that we have evolutionary universals that we apply to biological evolution, there's evolutionary universals that we could apply to cultural evolution, all cultures, all contexts, all scales. So that is amazing when you think of it.
All right, so David, this is not on the list of questions, but you know the way our conversations usually go, we touch on topics that are outside of the planned intelligent design parameter space and they evolve. So you're talking about diversity of, you know, cultures and whatnot. And, you know, something that I've been observing, and, you know, I'll just get your take on it. I feel within your subculture of academia, I feel that there are some issues with, you know, the term is viewpoint diversity. And I think that that is causing some, I mean, concretely, there's going to be, there is, and there's going to be major conflict between, you know, half of America that is not on the left and academia because of the polarization that's happening. And, you know, I have friends in academia who are from, you know, the minority culture in academia. And it's very different. I mean, when we first started talking, like I think the first time I had a discussion with you, 2010, everyone knows that academics are on the whole liberal, but, you know, there were still a substantial minority that were not. And that's just how it was. And today, it's very, very, I mean, it's very, very difficult if you are not on that political team. The distribution is very, very constrained and pushed over. And so I think that this is a serious problem. When I talk to academics in terms of, I have many friends who are not themselves, you know, they're not communists or anything. They're just normal academics, but they don't know any people outside of their narrow political window. They also are totally, you know, fundamentally ignorant of the hostility that some of the things that are happening in academia and the things that academics are saying about the public are eliciting. And I think that this is, I think it's the iron law of institutions where, you know, people can flourish within an institution, but the institution itself can eventually degrade its effectiveness. I think that's what's happening, honestly. And I just wanted to get your take on it because you've been involved in the game way longer than me. And, you know, you've seen things come and go. And you alluded earlier to, you know, your own belief that, you know, multi-level selection theory was hampered by sociological dynamics, not just, oh, what do the numbers add up to, you know? So I know that's like a big question, but I just want to get your take because, you know, I think you also look a little bit more broad in your interactions with people, I think, than some academics.
Yeah, well, it's interesting to hear you talk this way. And in some ways, that's not the world I know. So I'll get to that in a minute. But I also left academia. I mean, I always have one foot in academia, but I have my other foot elsewhere, and perhaps that's why that's not the world I know. A point to make is that if you look historically at major trends in science, even things as like continental drift, which now we look back and we say, of course, continents drift, but did you know it took about 50 years for that to become established? And so, you know, 50 years historically is about the time scale that major developments do take place. And in that sense, the group selection controversy kind of fits into that window. I mean, I'm a big believer in cultural catalysis. In fact, I love that analogy that just imagine that you can increase the rate of a chemical reaction by orders of magnitude by sprinkling in a substance in small amounts. Incredible. Can we do that, please, for cultural evolution? So I do think that if we know what to do, we can cause positive cultural change to happen in years, not decades. But I do think also, in fact, let me, there's a wonderful book I read at the suggestion of Ed Gibney, who is a wonderful person who could have been a philosophy professor. That's not where life took him. Now he's doing the same thing, a little bit like you, I would say, you know, a rich intellectual life of the mind without being in academia. And he pointed me to a book called The Murder of Professor Schlick, which is a history of the Vienna Circle between the two world wars in Vienna. It was the birth of positivism in philosophy. So it was the period between the two world wars in Vienna, this vibrant period. In many respects, it was like a cultural renaissance. What was it about Vienna? And it had little to do with the universities. The universities were conservative bastions at that time, very little taking place. And what made Vienna vibrant was the coffee house culture. There were hundreds and hundreds of coffee houses, and people formed into circles, and those circles were fluid. And that's where the action was taking place. And I think that now, if we want to know where's the action, yes, of course, it's taking place in universities to a degree, but no, actually, the internet is providing the potential for international coffee house culture, which is, for me, what we're trying to create in ProSocial. And it's so very, very exciting that anybody can play. It can be fully international. There's so much positive working material with this that's where the action is. And so that's why I'm so happy not operating through a university and basically creating our own action as we are here. I think you're a part of that.
Thank you. Thank you. You know, so every time I talk to you, David, you have this like new, like kind of ambitious project, you know? So, and I always like, okay, so what are you doing? So talk about ProSocial. Like, let's figure, I'm curious, like what you're doing and what your aim is, and besides saving the world or whatever, you know what I mean? Like there is, you do have big ambitious goals with evolution and, you know, evolution for every, like a lot of your books, and I'll link to them for the listeners and viewers outline this, but like talk about ProSocial.
Well, what I do, since we're drawing to a close, is encourage anyone listening to this to first go to www.prosocial.world. That's easy to remember. We have a new website which explains us. And then Google ProSocial Commons within ProSocial World. The ProSocial Commons is a kind of a big sandbox or a skunk works that anybody can join. And starting from where they are, no matter where they are currently in their thinking, they can go on from there in a very participatory and co-created fashion. And for example, one thing that we're just starting up is what we call a learning to action group on child development and education. There's a topic for you. There's a contemporary. Now, why is there an anxiety epidemic in children, which is said to be. Do we blame the internet, as Jonathan Haidt thinks? Or might it actually be more broad and have to do with our whole conception of education, as Peter Gray thinks, with a lot of, did you know that the suicide rate of students is twice as high during the school year as when school is in than when school is out? Might that have something to tell us? Might it be that the whole structure of education has become an individual level competition, has really forced us into this competitive mode? What might we do about it? What are some positive examples? So we're trying to create that coffee house culture, basically. And that's our effort. We collaborate with many other parallel efforts. It's very positive. And I would just welcome our listeners into that world. And one of the main portals is ProSocial Commons and ProSocial World. So if this conversation can be a funnel, then that would be great.
Yes. Yeah. I hear the word funnel a lot in the startup world. So, you know, there's some synthesis going on there, and I see what you're doing. It's great. I feel I will probably talk to you like this again in 2 or 3 years, and I think there will be something different happening because you're a dynamic person, David, and you're always doing something new, something ambitious, which is great because you know, there needs to be a little bit more of that in the world, in my opinion. That's my own culturally biased view as an American. Dynamism and change are good because that's how we experiment, that's how we learn. And for the listeners out there, I'll put a link to all your books and stuff like that. I will say that I do appreciate, you know, I talk to a lot of different people, David, and, you know, we've talked on and off, we're not like close friends or anything, but I love the expansiveness of your vision and your mind, and I've learned a lot from it. And I think that the listeners, just looking over your books and your papers, could also learn a lot from it because, I guess what I'm trying to say is there's some people who are very narrowly focused in their scholarship, and you can get a lot from that. For the type of people that are, I know there's a lot of retirees who are just like expanding their horizons that listen to me and view me. I know because you email me a lot. David's oeuvre is very, very, I think, accessible to a lot of us because there's always something in there for everyone. And I think that you guys should check it out. Check out the links. And thank you for your time, David. It's been great.
Thanks. I do attribute that to the theory, not my personal attributes. And so I'm always at pains to say that anybody can enter this world and this expansive world. It's the theory, not the person. And so that's my final word.
All right. Thank you, David.
This podcast for kids. Yeah.